A very good morning. In our previous class, we discussed Matthew Arnold's poem Thyrsus, few paragraphs, a few stanzas of the poem, where Arnold is describing his visits to Oxford, the countryside, after the death of his friend Clo, and how he is shocked to find out that how man-made things have undergone radical changes. Then he says the countryside is plunged in darkness, the poet cannot see the road leading to the hilltop. And then he says, Oxford looks lonely throughout the year. The poet is, you know, roaming around through the light and shadow. He wonders how he can no longer recognize all the familiar spots of Oxford. And then he says, since the death of Clo, his fellow seeker of truth, his visits to Oxford have become few and far between. And then he made a comparison and he's contrasted Cuckoo and Clo. So the cuckoo leaves England as soon as the spring is over. Similarly, he says that my friend, has also left the place, that is the Oxford. So now with this, we are going to move forward with our explanation. And your poet begins with, "Too quicker disappearer, wherefore wilt thou go? Soon will the high midsummer palms come on. Soon will the musk carnations break and swell. Soon shall we have gold-dusted snapdragon. Sweet William with his homely cottage smell, and stalks in fragrant blow, roses that down that valley shine afar, and open jasmine muffled lattices, and groups under the dreaming garden tree, and full moon and the white evening stars." So after making a comparison of Clo and Cuckoo, your poet, you know, moves forward, and he says the poet wonders why the cuckoo so easily gives way to disappear. So he says because he has mentioned that as soon as the spring season is over, the cuckoo leaves the area. And then he is asking cuckoo a question that why? Too quick despairer, wherefore wilt thou go? So where will you go? And why you are too quick to go into despair? So why are you getting so despair? Why are you feeling so desperate about all these things? And why you are leaving this place? So the vernal flowers have no doubt faded away. So the vernal flowers are the beautiful flowers that are there. The different flowers that your poet is talking about. For example, midsummer palms, musk carnation, then gold-dusted snapdragons, sweet William. These are all flowers which he is talking about. So he says that those flowers have faded away. But the flowers of the midsummer will shortly bloom. But he says all those flowers that have faded now, they are going to bloom again. They'll come into existence again. So you're going to have a display, beautiful display of all these, you know, flowers again in midsummer. So why you are not, you know, spending your time here? The carnations with their sweet odor will open their petals. The snapdragon with golden pollen. Snapdragon, golden dusted, is something which has a golden pollen. So it is going to be there. The sweet William with its homely smell, roses repellent in the garden walks, and jasmine flowers on the lattice of the windows with all blossom in midsummer. The full moon and the evening star will heighten the beauty of nature. So he says all these flowers that are being mentioned in your particular stanza, he says all these flowers are going to grow back again in midsummer. And full moon and the white evening stars are going to be there. So your, you know, the nature, your nature is going to be beautiful again. Everything is going to back to normal. So he says, so why you are getting so impulsive that you are ready to leave the place? And he says, all those things that are there are going to come back. And then again, he says, he hearkens not light comer, he is flown. And what matters is next year he will return, and we shall have him in the sweet spring days, with whitening hedges and uncrumpling fern, the bluebells trembling by the forest ways, and scent of a hay new moon. But Thyrsus never come, we swans shall we see him come back and cut a smoother reed, and blow a strain the world at last shall heed, for time not cordon hath conquered thee. And then he says, your poet says he hearken not. He hearken not is the cuckoo does not listen to the poet. He here refers to the cuckoo, but he says, but cuckoo is not referring to, because cuckoo leaves England but would return next year. He says, light comer, he's flown. What matters? It will next year he will return. So he here is for the cuckoo, and he says, but cuckoo is going to return back. When it is going to return back? In the sweet spring days. When what is going to happen? So it is a light-hearted visitor which comes and goes at its sweet will. Its departure, therefore, has to be ignored. It is sure to return to Oxford Nest next year at the advent of the spring at Oxford. So the moment the spring season is going to be back, who is going to come back? This cuckoo is going to come back. And what is going to happen? The bluebells are trembling in the woods. The new-mown hay exudes a pleasant smell. But Clo will not no more see the fellow shepherds, that is the fellow poets. Clo will not sing delightful songs to entertain the world. Clo has been defeated not by Croden, that is Matthew Arnold, but by death itself. So for what the poet is trying to tell, that the cuckoo is going to come back, but who would not be there? His friend, his fellow poet would not be there. And who's the fellow poet? Arthur Hugh Clo is the fellow poet. So he says he's not going to return. Arnold and Clo are no contestant, he said, and he died a natural death. So what reference he is talking about? Corden is a reference which has occurred in Elogue of Virgil. Virgil has been written by this person, and he says it is the reference that has been given to this thing. So he says poet expect that Clo would sing again, but he says what is not going to happen? This is not going to happen because he has died a natural death, and Arthur Hugh Clo will not return. The cuckoo will return, but Arthur Hugh Clo would not return. The poet says, alack for Croden, no rival now, but when Sicilian shepherds lost the mate, some good survivor with his flute would go, piping a ditty sad for Bayan's fate, and cross the unpermitted fairies flow, and relax Pluto's brow, and make leap up with joy the beauteous head of Proserpine, among whose crowns here are flowers first opened on Sicilian air, and flute his friend like Orpheus from the dead. So a lot of reference are being used here. So alack here refers to as now, unfortunately. Cordon is for Arnold, has no rival. Now, who was the rival? Who he's representing as rival? Arthur Clo, he was representing as rival, but he says now he has no rival because of his death. So when Sicilian shepherds lost a mate. So Sicilian shepherds are the people or the pastoral poets of Sicily. And mate is for his friend. His name was Bayan. His friend Mocus wrote an elegy. Arnold has written an elegy for Clo. Similarly, Bayan wrote for on the death of Bayan, his friend Mocus wrote an elegy. Some good survivor with his flute would go. Who is that good survivor? A friend who survived, piping a ditty sad for Bayan's fate. So ditty sad is here for an elegy. For Bayan's fate. So a pastoral poet who was poisoned to death in 300 BC. So who died? Bayan died. Who was Bayan? Bayan was a pastoral poet who was poisoned to death in 300 BC. And crossed the unpermitted fairies flow. Fairy over the river Styx that flows between earth and hell. So it's basically, they say it's a river that flows underground and which leads you to hell. And who are you going to find there? And relax Pluto's bro. How are you going to relax Pluto's bro? So you're going to sing song for him so that he would be moved by it. And who's Pluto? God of the underworld. And make leap up with joy and beauteous head of Proserpine. Proserpine is Pluto's wife, among whose crowns here are flowers first open on Sicilian air. And flute his friend like Orpheus. Who's Orpheus? So famous singer of ancient Greece, who went underworld to bring back his dead wife, Eurydice. So he says, that is why I said a lot of references are being used. And similarly, you can see here that I've also mentioned that in the stanza 9 and 10, he's recalling the Sicilian tradition of playing a sad song on pipe when a shepherd dies, so that in Hades, Proserpine would return the dead to life. So however, Arnold knows that since Proserpine has never been to England, it is futile to try and call on her. So Corden, that is Arnold, has no rival now. For Thyrsis, that is Clo, his only rival is no more. The poet recalls the pastoral poets of Sicily on the death of Bayan. His friend Mocus wrote an elegy to commemorate him. Overwhelmed with grief, Mocus expressed his desire to cross the river Styx in underworld so that he could, like Orpheus, the greatest singer of ancient Greece, move Pluto, the god of the underworld, and his queen Proserpine to pity, whose head was bedecked with flowers of Sicily. By softening Pluto and Proserpine to pity, Mocus also could bring his friend to life. So what he is saying, that he says, I'm going to go back where? I'm going to go to this underworld, the river which leads us to underworld, and I'm going to ask what? I'm going to ask Pluto to give you back to me. So in the next stanza he says, oh, easy access to the hero's grace, when Dorian shepherd sang to Proserpine, for she herself had trod Sicilian fields. She knew the Dorian water gush divine. She knew each lily white which Enna yields, each rose with blushing face. She loved the Dorian pipe, the Dorian strain. But ah, oh poor Thames, she never heard her foot the comer. Klaus lips never stirred, and we would tease her with our plaint in vain. So what is he trying to say here? He's, you know, progressing further with the same reference that he has given in the previous stanza. And he says, Mocus, the poets of Sicily, could have an easy access to Proserpine, for she belonged to Sicily. So, oh, easy access to the hearer's grace, when Dorian shepherd sang to Proserpine. So, it's because Mocus was a poet of Sicily, and Proserpine was also belonged to Sicily. She was familiar with the divine Dorian poetry. She knew each rose with red color and each white lily that bloomed in the Enna garden. An English poet that Arnold is, he cannot, however, hope to have access to Proserpine, who does not know English, nor does she has any knowledge of the Thames or the Cumnor Hill, bedecked with cowslips. Hence, it would be futile to move her heart with English songs or poetry and induce her to send back Clo alive. So what is he trying to tell here? He says, it's because this lady, Proserpine, has never been to England. She would not be able to understand the poetry or the music that these people are creating. And it would be futile. It would not be worth it to ask her to give Clo back. Why? Because the lamentation by which he's trying to, you know, prove his point would go futile. So, well, wind dispersed and vain the words will be. Yet, Thyrsus, let me give my grief its hour. In the old haunt and find our tree-popped hill, who, if not I, for questing here hath power? I know the wood which hides the daffodil, I know the five-field tree, I know that wide what purple fritillaries, the grassy harvest of river fields, above by Ensham, down by Stanford yield, and what sage brooks are Thames tributaries. So what is he trying to tell here? So his words, you know, will be dispersed by the wind. Still the poet must give vent to his feelings of grief. He says, though I know that I would not be able to, you know, make you bring back to you life again, but still what I want to do, he says, I want my words to be dispersed by the wind. And he says, I want a vent of my feelings in the old haunt. Old haunt is here for Oxford. And find out a tree-topped hill. So tree is here referring to the elm tree. I know the wood which hides the daffodil. So he says, I know the wood which hides the daffodils, or I know of the village. Fifield is a village that is near Oxford. And he says, fritillaries are a kind of plant yielding flowers. And Ensham and Stanford are two villages, again, two villages in Oxford. And Sedges reads on the river bank. So he says, I know all these things, but still I would not be able to bring back to life. So the poet words will be dispersed by the wind, and his voice will not reach Proserpine's ears. Still the poet must give vent to his feelings of grief for his friend Thyrsus, because the latter during his lifetime was thoroughly familiar with the Oxford countryside. He will now find out the hill crowned with lone elm tree. He knows the woods with which the daffodils hides the tree at Fifield, the white and purple flowers blooming on the bank of the Thames, the village, the small village is known as Ensham and Stanford, and the tributaries of the Thames, the banks of which are overgrown with sedges. So he says, though Proserpine doesn't know England, but his friend has known Oxford very beautifully. So he says, at least I want my words to get dispersed in the wind so that all these things can hear to it. So I know these slopes, who knows them if not I, but many a tingle on the loved hillside, with thorns once subdued old wild white blossom trees, where thick the cowslip grew and far descried, high towered the spikes of purple orchids, had since our day put by, the coronals of that forgotten time, each down green bank hath gone by the plough boy's team, and only in the hidden brookside gleam, primroses, orphans of the flowery prime. And then he says, the poet claims to know the hill slopes of Oxford much better than anybody, but since his last visit, things have undergone various changes. So in this particular stanza, he's talking about, again, going back to, the scenery in Oxford, and he says that there are changes, some things have undergone various changes. During his days as Oxford, the hill slopes were stuffed with bushes and shrubs, full of different kind of flowers, cowslips, and spiked orchids, which could be seen from afar, but now these flowers are seen no more. The banks on the Thames are under cultivation. Primroses are the only flowers of the spring which lie hidden as orphans on the river bank. So he says, this is the situation now. And then he moves forward and he says, where is the girl who by the boatman's door, above the logs, above the boating throng, unmoored our skim when through the whitened flats, red loose rife and blonde meadow sweet among, and darting swallows and light water guans, we tracked thy shy Thames shore. Where are the mowers who are the tiny swell of our boat, passing heave the river grass, stood with suspended sides to see us pass? They all are gone, and thou art gone as well. So in this stanza, he's remembering what? He's remembering a girl, and what is he trying to say? So when he's remembering a girl, he's saying, the poet recalls the day when he and Arthur Hughclaw enjoyed a boat trip on the Thames. The boatman's daughter was standing at the door and watching them closely. She unfastened their boat. They then proceeded among the Thames amidst the meadows, full of flowers and plants stretched between Wythen and the Thames. As the boat rushed along, the swallows and the water guans were frightened away. The mowers in the field suspended their work and watched them with curiosity. But as these lovely sights can be seen no more, so also cloak can be seen no more. So it's, poet recalls the day when he has enjoyed it with his friend. And he says these were the things that were happening at that particular time. So during the next several stanzas, the speaker walks through the countryside, lamenting all he had lost since Thyrsis has gone. He recalls a girl who once helped them with their boat and is sad to realize she has also disappeared. During the lament, he becomes overwhelmed with the world's problem in the larger scene. So, in the further stanzas, his mood brightens as he sees a group of jovial hunters. And, this is how he is progressing. So he says, yes, thou art gone and round me to the night. In ever-nearing circles weaves her shade. I see her veil draw soft across the day. I feel her slowly chilling breath in wade. The cheek grown thin, the brown hair sprent with grey. I feel her finger light, laid pausefully upon life's headlong trail. The foot less prompt to meet the morning dew. The heart less bounding at emotion new. And hope once crushed, less quick to spring again. So your poet says, Thyrsis has gone, never to return. The poet also feels the slow approach of death. So when he says her, when he's referring, in a ever nearing circle weaves her shade, so her is here for death. So the poet also feels the slow approach of death. He feels that he is aging. His cheeks have become thinner. So the cheek grown thin, and his brown hair is graying. He feels the touch of icy cold death. As a result of advancing age, he has no longer his former strength and stamina. His steps are slow. As he tries to climb the upland lawn in morning, and walk over the fields moist with dewdrops. He feels with regret that his emotional response to the objects of nature has lost its former warmth. He is in a state of despair. Because of the death of his friend, he is in a state of despair. He is experiencing the impact of old age upon his nerves and mind. So he says, though you have died, you have also died, and I can also feel what is happening, that death is approaching me. And with this approachment of death towards me, what is happening? I am getting more and more, getting this feeling of despair more and more. And our last stanza for today's class, and long the way appears, which seems so short to the less practiced eye of sanguine youth, and high the mountain tops in cloudy air, the mountain tops where is the throne of truth, tops in life's morning sun so bright and bare, unbreachable the fort, oh the long battered world uplifts its wall, and strange and vain the earthly turmoil grows, and near and real the charm of thy repose, and night as welcome as a friend would fall. So what is he trying to tell you here? So in he's describing about his youth time, and he says in his youth he thought the way to truth be short and easy, for which he is mentioning the and long the way appears, which seems so short. But now what is happening? In old age the way appears thorny and uphill long and aches some is tired, some troublesome. Whatever appeared to be easy in adolescence now appears extremely difficult. His mind is now clouded with doubts and frustration. He imagines that an insurmountable wall is blocking his passage to the citadel of truth. He is getting more and more disillusioned and thinks all his youthful idealism to be nothing but vanity. He grows jealous of Thyrsis, who has attained happiness in his grave. He will be glad to welcome death. So he says, I am not able to continue on with this feelings any longer. And what is happening with me? So the sanguine youth, the blood red color, the warm, which is full of hope. And you know now, but he's, and what is the throne of truth? It is looking for the elm tree. And he says, all these things which I thought in my youth time would be easier to approach, but now they seem difficult. And why all these things seem difficult? Because he says that death is approaching me too, and with the approachment of death, what is happening? I'm losing all my stamina, all my hope, all my desires that I had in my youth time. So I hope you have understood the poem. I hope you have understood the explanation that I gave you. But in case if you have any problem, you can post your comments on the classroom. For the rest of the poem that is left, we are going to do in our next class. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Study well. Stay safe. Thank you.